Yes, money, going to bar, going to drink. Absolutely.
Where is Parker?
When you look at the price, it's hard to, some of the,
Welcome to this eighth debate sponsored by the Soho Forum. I'm Gene Epstein, economics and book review editor of Barron's Financial Weekly and the director of the Soho Forum. The Soho Forum has a twofold mission. First, to present sizzling debates between brilliant people on issues that interest freedom-loving folks and power-loving folks are also cordially welcome. And second, just as important, the Soho Forum is meant to be a place where people can socialize and get to know each other. That's the purpose of the wine and cheese reception, which has already started and will last until 9 o'clock. In an age of soundbite and speed talking, the Soho Forum aims to slow down the dialogue and allow people to talk in paragraphs. That's a key reason why our debates will always be one against one rather than the more conventional two against two, in order to give our debaters more time, adequate time, to explain their views. The Soho Forum for me is a labor of love, in part because it's run by a group of loving volunteers that include my wife, Hisoko Kobayashi, who prepares all the food, and by my friends, John Kunze, and by my co-founder, Naomi Brockwell, who is kneeling by the stage right now. And thanks especially to the Smith Family Foundation for providing us with the financial backing, and to Julie Smith for handling all our bills, and for Don Smith, who's sitting right in the front right now, for taking a chance on us a long time ago, it seems, when we were only a gleam in my eye and in Don's. Julie Smith has gone on maternity leave, which is why the Soho Forum has linked up with the folks at the Reason Foundation to administer our affairs, to promote our product. That, too, is a family thing for me, since my son, Jim Epstein, is one of the prominent reporters at Reason. Next month, on Tuesday, May 16th, Lawrence Ross, author of Blackballed, The Black and White Politics of Race on America's Campuses, will be defending the following resolution against Camille Foster of the libertarian podcast, The Fifth Column. The resolution will read, America's colleges have fostered a racist environment that makes them a hostile space for African American students. Tickets have already gone on sale for that event, and we expect a sellout crowd. So I suggest you buy your ticket right away for that. Tonight's resolution, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation should be abolished in favor of private sector solutions for protecting the safety of bank deposits. Read that one more time. The Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation should be abolished in favor of private sector solutions for protecting the safety of bank deposits. Here to explain the voting procedure, our marketing director and Soho founder, co-founder, Naomi Brockwell.
Welcome, everyone. If you haven't been to the Soho Forum before, we do all of our voting online, electronically. So if you take out your smartphones, you will find posted around the venue our website. If you go to sohovote.com, you'll find the resolution there, which is Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation should be abolished in favor of private sector solutions for protecting the safety of bank deposits. So you, if you agree with that already, then you can click yes, or if you don't know, if you don't know yet, you haven't made up your mind, click undecided. We will be taking votes again at the end, so keep in mind that your vote doesn't actually get counted by the system unless you vote twice, because the whole purpose of this is to see who picks up the most votes. And while you're doing that, I also encourage everyone to connect with us on social media, on Twitter, the Soho Forum, or on Facebook, and you can also subscribe to our YouTube channel and our podcast on iTunes as well. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Naomi. Yeah. Now, As part of our tradition at the Soho Forum, we begin with a warm-up act from a great libertarian comic, in this case, Andrew Heaton. Andrew is a recent TV producer, the host of a show called Mostly Weekly, and he's the author of a great collection of essays called Laughter is Better Than Communism. Now, for the main event, you have been speaking, thinking at all times about the resolution. George Selgin, in this corner of the Cato Institute, will be defending the following resolution against Josh Barro, a Business Insider, sitting here. The Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation should be abolished in favor of private sector solutions for protecting the safety of bank deposits. After the debate, George Selgin will be selling this book, Money, Free and Unfree. It lists for $24.95. You can have it for a $20 bill, an offer you can't refuse. He'll be signing and selling these books for $20 bills after the debate. But meanwhile, you want to listen to George. I had invited George Selgin to debate Roger Lowenstein, formerly of the Wall Street Journal. He had written a book about the Federal Reserve. George had actually done a review of that book for Barron's, which I had published. Roger Lowenstein kept declining the possibility, the invitation to debate George, maybe because he thinks George is too much of a demon over the debating table. Josh Barro is obviously not afraid of him. So let's launch in. George, you have 15, no, just a moment, we have to close the voting, sorry. I got carried away with the drama. We have to close the voting. You've already voted, and Naomi, you're closing the voting on that resolution because you can't vote when George starts to make his case. Closed voting. George, you have 15 minutes to defend the proposition. Take it away, George.
Thank you, Gene. Well, I suppose most people who are here tonight are wondering how anyone could oppose deposit insurance. So I want to start by telling you that I don't oppose it because I like seeing your grandmothers and grandfathers lose their life savings. And I don't oppose it because I love banking panics. I oppose it because despite what many people believe, despite what I suppose most of you believe, deposit insurance has done a lot more harm than good. And there are better ways to protect small depositors and avoid banking crises. I want to start by arguing that deposit insurance was actually never a good idea. Most apologies for deposit insurance go back to its beginnings in this country on a national level during the Great Depression, and that's fine. That's how it should be. But the apologists for insurance, what they say happened back then and what actually happened are completely different things. Now, the part that everyone agrees on is that the FDIC and also its former sister organization, the FSLIC, Federal Savings and Loans Insurance Corporation, were established back in the during the New Deal as part of the 1933 Banking Act. And that act was passed in the wake of thousands of bank failures by which many small depositors lost all or part of their savings. Yet, and this is where the truth and the legend depart, deposit insurance was never about protecting small depositors, and it wasn't about making the banking system as a whole safer. On the contrary, what it was about was propping up and preserving a very bad banking system known as a unit banking system. Now, a unit bank is a bank with one location only. It has no branches. It has very limited opportunities for diversifying its assets, loans, or otherwise. It's an inherently risky operation. And almost all the failures of the 1930s, and also large numbers of failures in the 20s, for that matter, were of small unit banks, especially in local areas. Now, to give you some idea of just how important unit banking was, California was one of the few states at the time that had branch banking, at least throughout the state. Not a single California bank failed in the 30s. A better example is Canada, where Nationwide branching was the norm, and not a single Canadian bank failed, even though Canada was hit very hard by the Depression. Now, there was no generalized panic in the United States despite all these failures. The closest, what happened, in fact, was not that banks failed because depositors were taking their money out, but rather that depositors were taking their money out because they thought their banks were in danger of failing for other reasons, and they were, for the most part, correct. The only thing that actually resembled a true nationwide panic was what happened in late February, March 1933. But that wasn't a panic because people didn't trust their banks. It was a run on gold because they thought that FDR, who was about to take office, might devalue the gold standard, which of course he eventually did. Now that can't happen again, folks. So to the extent that that was the cause of a nationwide run, it was something that would never be repeated afterwards since we went off the gold standard. Now it's important for you to realize that most reformers, while the Depression was happening and while the bank failures were happening, thoughtful people wanted to reform the system by introducing branch banking to the United States, which they'd been trying to do for a long time. It looked like finally this crisis would allow it to happen. FDR, by the way, was among the people who preferred that solution to deposit insurance, which he was thoroughly against. In fact, he threatened to veto any bill that provided for it. He said, with regard to deposit insurance, I quote, "We do not wish to make the United States government liable for the mistakes and errors of individual banks and thereby put a premium on unsound banking in the future." And this, as we shall see, was a quite sound opinion. But deposit insurance had a powerful proponent in Henry Stiegel, who was the Republican, nota bene, chairman of what was the House Committee on Banking and Currency. Not coincidentally, he represented a state, Alabama, that was heavy with unit banks. Stiegel wasn't interested in creating a sound system. He wanted to put unit banking on life support, so he blocked every proposal for branch banking reform and pushed through deposit insurance with the help of a well-motivated lobby of predominantly rural unit bankers. And if you don't believe that his goal was to save the unit bankers and not to have a better system, let me quote from Stiegel himself. He said of his legislation, "This bill will preserve independent dual banking," that is, unit banking, "in the U.S. That is what the bill is intended to do." Now, FDR eventually caved in, signing the 1933 Banking Act, including the deposit insurance provision. But he did so only after complaining that this deposit insurance scheme he kept trying so hard to kill had, quote, "more lives than a cat," unquote. Now, deposit insurance did not restore confidence in the nation's banks, contrary to what you may have heard. It couldn't have. The Banking Act of 1933 didn't even pass till June 13th of 33, and temporary deposit insurance didn't get started till January 34. The real deal started a year later. Yet the banks were reopened at the end of the bank holiday starting on March 13th, 1933, and people lined up to put their cash back in. What was the reason for that? Remember what I said about the run on gold? Well, during the holiday, through a series of executive orders, Roosevelt made it illegal for banks to pay out gold any longer, and then he made it illegal for people to hold the gold they already had. They had to turn it in. So naturally, they lined up to undo what they'd done before the panic. There was no way around it, and there was no more reason to panic because the main reason for the big panic in January, February 33 was over. That was the fear of devaluation. They couldn't do anything about it anymore. All right, that's the background. What about the results? Deposit insurance has been a costly failure. The root problem of government-mandated deposit insurance, which economists call moral hazard, is or ought to be obvious to anyone. It is, to quote from one economist's summary, "the very fact that insurance protects depositors, which means that the threat of deposit withdrawals or of not getting deposits in the first place no longer discourages bank managers from taking big risks." That is, to the extent that coverage is there. Deposit insurance tends to destroy the market for sound banking, making risky banks the only game in town, which is, by the way, what FDR was worried about, him and a lot of other people. Now, part of the problem with insurance, government insurance, has always been that they don't charge risk-adjusted premiums. In fact, for many, many years, the FDIC charged a flat rate premium of 1/12 of 1% to all banks, never mind whether they were good or bad. And that was assessed against their total, not just their insured deposits. Riskier banks, mainly the smaller ones in those days, gained at the expense of safer ones. So think about it. After all, what does a fully insured depositor look for in a bank? Safety? Forget about it. Convenience, maybe. Attractive checks? Could be. Interest? You better believe it. Now, there were many long, quiet years. From 34 to the 1960s, the combination, that was a reason why it seemed to work well. The combination of limited coverage and New Deal banking restrictions passed at the same time as deposit insurance itself kept a lid on the moral hazard problem. It limited banks' ability to attract depositors by making and offering to share the earnings from risky loans. In particular, it didn't allow banks to pay interest on deposits, so how could they attract you by saying they were going to give you part of a risky investment portfolio's return? But deposit insurance's seeming success during those quiet years was both misleading and unsustainable. The success, first of all, was very costly, as a very good economist who happens to be here tonight, Hugh McCulloch, has noted, I quote, "The public paid dearly for deposit safety, not directly through explicit premiums, but indirectly through foregone interest." Remember, banks couldn't pay them interest. "Foregone interest on deposits and higher interest on loans. These costs added up, according to McCulloch, to hundreds of basis points on insured deposits, or far more than the average coverage's average fair market value." The banks were the big gainers in this by the monopoly profits the restrictions allowed them to earn. So that was the cost of these quiet years. But that quiet was unsustainable. Starting in the 1960s, competitive pressures mounted, as did inflation, compelling regulators to loosen the regulatory restrictions both on banks and on savings and loans. The limits on deposit insurance coverage were also raised repeatedly, as always, in response to pressure from the weakest banks. They went from $5,000 before 1950, to which they'd been raised not long after the Depression, from $2,500, to $100,000 in 1980. That's much more than the increase in prices during that same period. Legislation passed in 1980 also phased out limits on banks and S&L's ability to attract deposits by paying interest on them. Thanks to these developments, the lid on the moral hazard problem was lifted, and the problem went quickly from latent to blatant. The great unraveling took place in the 60s, first with the S&L crisis. Over 1,000 thrifts or S&Ls, half the industry failed. The less capital they had left, the bigger the risks they took. And that was only because of deposit insurance, which is predicted to have that effect. According to McCulloch again, it would never have happened, the S&L mess, if the federal deposit insurance protection hadn't encouraged depositors to keep their funds in thrifty institutions that followed the unsound practice of speculating against an increase in interest rates. By the way, by a conservative thumbnail estimate that I did myself, the S&L mess cost taxpayers about three to four times as much in constant dollars as the 1930s bank failures. That was just the losses from S&Ls for the 80s. Commercial bank failures also rose in numbers, and the FDIC nearly went broke twice. It had to turn hat in hand to the Treasury for support. According to the economic historian Eugene Nelson White, the cost of the FDIC insurance for the whole 1945 to 96 period that he studied exceeded reasonable estimates of the likely cost of bank failures had there been neither an FDIC nor any other New Deal banking reforms. In the rest of the world, the results of the deposit insurance were the same. Deposit insurance sadly spread like a cancer. It started in the US alone, No other country adopted it until Canada did in 67, but in the 70s, 80s, and especially the 90s, it spread ultimately to 112 countries. New Zealand's about the only one that doesn't have it. In none of those cases, or the vast majority of them, was there any precipitating crisis. Canada, the second country to adopt deposit insurance, hadn't seen a bank failure since 1923. The UK, which adopted it in the 1970s, hadn't seen one since 1878. But the results were disastrous. In everywhere, all around, according to major studies, bank failures and crises became more frequent than ever. And I could cite you some very painstaking studies that show this, including one that I quote from: the relationship between deposit insurance and bank fragility around the world is economically large. I think I have a minute or two to talk about better ways to protect depositors from losses and encourage prudent banking. And I'm going to just go through the list very quickly. I could come up with more of these. First, most important, a structurally sound and well-diversified banking system. It's easy to forget that the best ways to keep depositors safe is to make it possible and profitable for banks to be safe. High capital and lower leverage ratios. Deposit insurance and capital are substitutes. The minute deposit insurance kicks in, capital goes down. Capital will go up if you get rid of deposit insurance, or you can force it to go up and then get rid of it. Extended shareholder liability was a very good device for limiting risk-taking by banks. They abolished it here and elsewhere after implementing insurance because they thought you didn't need it anymore. Private insurance is possible. I'll give you just one example. Germany from 1975 to 1998 had privately managed and funded deposit insurance, and it worked very well. According to a study of that system, German banks took very low risks compared to banks in other countries and did not seem able to attract any subsidy from the financial safety net. It was a mutual insurance system, by the way. We have a very good study by Bert Ely that talks about this, but I'm going to just go on and mention one more factor: avoid unsound monetary policy, which was one of the biggest causes of bank failures. In conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, government deposit insurance is a profoundly defective scheme, originally foisted on the people of this country by politicians laboring on behalf of special interest groups. They sold us a bit of goods. I think our next speaker will try to sell you the same bill of goods all over again.
Okay. Yeah.
Do the world a favor, don't buy it.
Josh, this is what, Okay, Josh, take it away. You get an extra 25 seconds, Josh, because the other, but here to speak against the resolution, Josh Barro.
Thanks, Gene, and thank you, George. I appreciate that. I want to be very clear. We're not here to debate the question of whether deposit insurance should have been established during the Great Depression, nor are we here to debate the general question of whether deposit insurance is a good idea, whether one should establish one in a state of nature. We actually went back and forth about this before the debate, and for a very specific reason, I wanted to debate the question we're debating, which is, should we abolish the FDIC or not? Because this is the system we have, we know a lot about the system, how it works, growing pains that the system has had, and we've learned a lot over 80 years about how to work within a system of deposit insurance. If we were to abolish the system and move to something new at a time when as George noted, substantially every major high-income country around the world, with the exception of New Zealand, has a system of explicit deposit insurance now, if we strike out in some new direction, we have to learn all over again. We're going to have to go through a trial and error process of figuring out how that system would work. And so I want to talk about some of those lessons that we've learned relatively recently and what they would mean for us if we were to abolish deposit insurance. Now, broadly, of course, the United States and the world went through a large financial crisis that started in 2008. And one of the things that we learned in that crisis was that the government had made more promises than we knew it had. There were all sorts of things that taxpayers were on the hook to pay for that they had never explicitly agreed to pay for. And I don't just mean that politicians decided that taxpayers would pay for things that they had not agreed to pay for. They, in fact, realized that economic circumstances and political circumstances and social circumstances existed such that it was untenable not to pay certain things. There were certain creditors who were going to have to be made whole, whether or not the government had decided that in advance, whether or not it had collected a premium from them, whether or not we liked it. And small and medium-sized depositors are among that list of people who will be made whole, whether we like it or not. We saw this in the reaction in countries all over the world to the financial crisis. We had very different deposit insurance schemes all over the world. You had countries like Australia, which at the time had no deposit insurance. You had places where limits were much lower than in the US, where you had co-insurance, where depositors were expected to bear part of the loss alongside the banks that failed. And what you found was that all across the world, governments decided that that system was untenable and that they would make bigger promises than they had made ex ante. You saw Australia establish a deposit insurance system on an emergency basis in October 2008, deciding it was not tenable to not have deposit insurance. Even New Zealand temporarily established a deposit insurance system, which they maintained for several years, in the heart of that crisis. You also saw moves nationalizations of banks or government guarantees of financial institutions, places like Northern Rock, UBS, banks all over the world, even if the government was not stepping in to explicitly bail out the depositors, it was bailing out the banks and therefore having the effect of protecting the depositors, which is to say that we're going to have deposit insurance. We can decide not to have the FDIC. We can decide not to have an explicit regime of government guarantees, but when the crisis becomes really bad, those guarantees will be performed on, and the question will just be, did we impose rules on banks in the meantime? Did we collect premiums from those banks in the meantime? What that also means is we're going to have the moral hazard, whether we like it or not. Depositors saw that we went through this process in the 2008 crisis. They knew that the government was there for them when they needed the government, and they can accurately predict the government will be there the next time. So if we abolish the FDIC, we can't even expect that we will get the benefit you're describing of discipline imposed by the depositors on those institutions, because those depositors will reasonably expect that the government will bail them out. So my contention is that we cannot credibly commit to do the things that you would like to commit to do. Now, I would note one conceivable way around this is a system of private deposit insurance. You might say, well, the depositors must be made whole. We know they'll be made whole. So we want to move that obligation off onto the balance sheet of a private insurer. The problem with this is then you've just moved the locus of the guarantee, because then the insurer will be unable to fail. If the depositor must be made whole, then the insurer will be there as the first line of defense, but the government will be there to back up the insurer in the event that it fails. And that, again, fails to address the moral hazard problem, because what happens in this situation? If the insurer is known to have a put to the government, then the insurer will be able to underprice, and the banks and the depositors will not have a good reason to police the insurer. One thing about deposit insurance is it relieves depositors of the obligation to try to figure out whether a bank is sound. That can be a difficult thing for an ordinary consumer to do. Now, you would hope that the insurer would do that, but then you still need the depositor to be able to figure out whether the insurer is good for the money. The depositor won't have to do that because they will know that the government will be there to back up the insurer in the event that it fails. And I would note again that this is insurance for an event that is strongly correlated. Bank failures are very likely to come all at the same time. So insurers moving into this new market, trying to figure out how to price this deposit insurance, will not have a quick learning curve. They will have to wait for a crisis to figure out how much they're likely to be on the hook to pay out in claims. And we saw this in the last few decades of financial products. We saw this with mortgage-backed securities, with CDOs, with credit default swaps. You had these novel products that companies were figuring out how to price, and you didn't really know how to price them until you saw how they performed in a crisis. And so you might say, well, we'll have sophisticated people at deposit insurers figure out how to price these. Well, you had sophisticated people at AIG pricing credit default swaps and pricing them wrong, partly because of the government put, but partly just because this stuff is hard and you need to go through several business cycles before you get it right. So maybe eventually they'd figure out how to do that pricing, but you A, have the problem of the government put, and you B, have the problem that we'd have to go through several very painful cycles of figuring out whether these insurers fail or not going into crises. We lose the benefit of those 80 years of learning that we've had with the FDIC. We have to go learn it back from stage one. I want to note additionally, I mean, the usual trade-off with deposit insurance that's posited is, you know, deposit insurance protects depositors, it discourages bank runs. On the other hand, you get this moral hazard problem where people don't police the banks for whether the bank is sound before they put their money in it. And if you think that's a big driver of risk-taking in the financial sector, then a question you need to ask yourself is, why did so many of the problem institutions in the 2008 crisis not depend principally or even at all on insured deposits to finance themselves. You saw markets for unsecured debt of banks. You saw markets for deposits that exceeded the deposit insurance limits. And then you also saw institutions that insurance companies that depend on their counterparties, which are the insureds. In each of those cases, you did not see effective policing where people said, well, gee, if I'm going to buy a credit default swap from AIG, how sure am I that AIG is sound? If I'm going to buy a bond issued by Bank of America, am I sure that Bank of America is sound? You did not see effective policing by those participants in the market. And so you could say two things about that. One is, well, some of them knew that they would be bailed out, that if there was a huge financial crisis like we had, the federal government would come in and say that too big to fail institutions, in fact, would not fail and unsecured bondholders and entities like Bank of America would be protected. But then you also saw some of these people who participated in these transactions that were horribly mispriced who did in fact have huge losses. You had people who lost a lot of money investing in mortgage bonds and things of that nature. And so that was just straight up mispricing. All of which is to say that if our goal is to say, well, if we have all the right price signals and then people won't take undue risk because they'll have to pay too much for taking the risk, that did not bear out in the lead up to the 2008 crisis. I'd also note as an aside on when you note about the problem of unit banking in the lead up to the Great Depression, and I agree that unit banking was problematic and branch banking would have allowed for more diversification that would have somewhat reduced bank failures. However, again, if we look at what has happened in the last 10 years, we have seen a lot of insolvencies and failures by large diversified banks. And so while diversification is an advantage in avoiding bank failure, it is not a silver bullet. And I don't think we could simply assume that if we allowed banks to be large and branched and diversified, that would avoid the problem of bank failures and therefore avoid the need to get into the question of whether deposits will be insured in the event of a failure or not. I want to talk broadly about prudence and conservatism in policymaking. And this is just this question of, should we move to something entirely new? Or should we try to improve on something we already have? And this is what arose with decisions that were made about how to regulate products such as credit default swaps and decisions by private market participants about how to price them. We thought that we had a financial system that was a lot more secure than it was going into 2008. We thought we knew things about it that we didn't. We thought we knew things about how these new products worked that we did not know. And we learned a lot. And so again, there is just this question of what will we learn about a world post-deposit insurance that we don't know, whereas we do know a lot about the world we exist in right now with the FDIC. And therefore, I would propose that there are certain ways that we can prove around the margins of the system that we have now, look at the problems that we know exist and try to make them somewhat less bad rather than going off and doing something entirely new. And I think I'm going to say some things that you may agree with here. One is that deposit insurance limits are too high. We offer more deposit insurance than we need to. The government could credibly insure a smaller fraction of deposits than it does now. Deposit insurance applies on a per institution basis. There's no need for that. We could have deposit insurance that was limited per person. I'm skeptical about how much this would do to discourage risk-taking among financial institutions because of the reasons that I mentioned, that even when people don't have insurance, they often don't seem to police the institutions effectively. But I do think it would make the system more equitable. There is no need to spend taxpayer money bailing out high-income people with large bank deposits who could afford to bear much of the loss on their own. I also think that we could do more to price it properly. I think they do better in the United Kingdom pricing deposit insurance premiums on the basis of actual risk borne by financial institutions. There's no reason that you need to have a flat or near flat premium. And finally, I would note that we should have higher capital requirements, as you say. No, I don't think higher capital requirements are a substitute for everything else that is done in bank regulation. Sometimes you see people float this idea with, well, you know, say that they have to have 20% equity and then we can let them do what they want. The problem is you could have a bank that had low leverage and had a portfolio that just consisted entirely of risky loans, and even at low leverage, it would be very risky. It would not be a substitute for deposit insurance and for the risk rating that goes with that. But I do think that it would reduce the ability of banks to benefit from the fact that their depositors are not effectively policing them for the risks that they are taking. Thank you.
5 minutes from George Selgin for rebuttal.
Yes, well, we have that 80 years. I'm sorry.
Pardon me, folks. We have had 80 years of experience with insurance, but I don't find much comfort in that because things have been getting worse rather than better. And I don't think that the events of the recent crisis prove anything other than that moral hazard works just as people who fear deposit insurance's effects think it works. We actually had an arrangement where, with these crises, what we saw was uninsured money flying away from risky institutions, which is just what you want to see happen. The money left bad banks to the extent that they weren't insuring all their deposits, and it flowed in big amounts to sound banks. It flowed out of WAMU, it flowed out of IndyMac. In the UK, it flowed out of Northern Rock because they didn't have 100% coverage for their deposits. And that's exactly what would happen systematically to bad banks if it was allowed. But these were not systematic runs on all banks. People forget that a lot of banks were gaining deposits during the 2008 and 9 crisis. They were the sounder banks. Now, I think we not only ought to experiment with alternatives. I believe we ought to strike out on our own because we owe it to the rest of the world. We're the ones who came up with this dumb idea, and then we foisted it on other countries, pressure from the IMF, from U.S. authorities. We actually went around like drug dealers telling every country that you want an IMF loan, by God, you need deposit insurance like the good old U.S. of A. That's how it spread. Theory. Pressure had nothing to do with the needs of other countries. We ought to them to fix our system so that we can encourage them to fix theirs. And it can work. Private deposit insurance doesn't necessarily work the way Josh suggested. It's not a matter of having a big insurance company or several that insure banks privately. What you have had in Germany and elsewhere are mutual guarantee systems where essentially all the depositors are, in a way, insuring one another. Now, I don't have time to go into a lot of detail, but Bert Ely wrote a very good paper for the Cato Institute showing how this system can work. But don't take Bert's word for it. Let me read what some experts at the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco had to say about the idea of a mutual insurance or cross-guarantee system. I quote, "The evidence regarding the practicability of mutual insurance is sufficiently encouraging to warrant a closer look at this proposal. The problems involved seem less onerous than those created by the current deposit insurance scheme," unquote. Now, you don't want to rely on any one of these things. Higher capital, double liability for bank shareholders, which used to exist, mutual insurance, better sound monetary policy, and all that. Together, they offer a perfectly compelling alternative to an obviously broken arrangement. Thanks.
But that story about how the uninsured money was moving where it was supposed to move is not at all a useful story about where uninsured money goes. The runs were too late. The money would go away from banks like WAMU when it was clear that WAMU was on the verge of failure. It was not going away from WAMU in 2005 or 2004 when that information would have actually been useful. It was not a matter of better supervising the balance sheet of WAMU. It was realizing at the time that members of the public were realizing that we were on the verge of bank failures. And the reason that run is not useful is that it's too late. You couldn't let WAMU fail. It would not have been possible to saddle the depositors with the obligations there. In fact, it was not even possible to saddle the bondholders with the obligations in many of these cases because the institutions were too big and too interconnected and the overall effects on the economy would have been too great. So yes, you do see that greater instability in the system, but that's not a sign that with uninsured deposits things would work better. It's actually a sign that they would work worse, that you would have less time to pick up the pieces and figure out how you were going to restructure your banking system out of the crisis that you saw there. And then as for the idea that, you know, we have an obligation to move the world away from from deposit insurance because it was our fault and we forced it on other countries through the IMF. We didn't force it on Australia through the IMF. We did not enforce deposit insurance on other high-income countries that have the ability to structure their own financial systems. This is a decision that those countries have made, in some cases in a deliberate fashion, in some cases in a moment of crisis when they realized that their system was not going to work without deposit insurance, or that they had already effectively made a promise to depositors that that their deposits were insured whether they liked it or not. So I think we should take heed from that. The whole world has been moving in the direction of deposit insurance for a reason, whether nudged that way or not. We would be moving off to something new and risky, and ultimately we wouldn't move there forever, because once a crisis hit, we would end up reestablishing deposit insurance for the same reason that other countries are establishing it anew in the first place. And then finally, I guess I would just address this issue that, we can't stay the course because things are getting worse after 80 years. I think we have a good thing going. I don't think our financial system is perfect. I don't think the FDIC is perfect. But this is a much wealthier, more prosperous, freer country than it was 80 years ago. And in the main, our economic system works, and we should be cautious about big changes to the system. We should have a bias toward figuring out a way to work within the frameworks that already exist in our country, rather than establishing new and risky ones. So I think, they're often, with libertarians, is this narrative of crisis and despair in the country, and I think, it's really much more a matter of making the right adjustments so that we make better choices in our financial system, rather than blowing up it up and doing something very new. Oh, I just want to talk about the mutual structure a little bit. So the idea, you don't have to have a third party insurer. You could have a mutual insurer. Although I would note that when these systems are drawn up, including the one that Bert drew up, they are compulsory. So in terms of, has that really gotten us away from government deposit insurance? Well, I mean, it's sort of like Obamacare, right? It's private insurance, but it's compulsory to carry it. There is a strong arm of government involved in there, and you can have attempts to have more or less government involvement in setting the terms. You can say, well, we'll let the mutuals set their own terms for these things, but ultimately, again, because the government is the insurer of last resort there, if these mutual insurers fail, then ultimately we know the government is going to come in and make the depositors whole. The government has an interest in making sure that the terms are set up in a way that serves the interests of the government and the taxpayers. And again, I would note, a lot of these systems have been drawn up, and I know Burt's paper precedes the 2008 financial crisis. They're drawn sort of aiming at dealing with something like the SNL crisis. These mutuals would be under considerably more stress in an event like the 2008 crisis, where you could have had failures of banks on the scale of Bank of America and Citigroup, in which case I think it is likely that some of the mutuals would have been overwhelmed in terms of their financial capacity to bail out. It would have worked within the context of the SNLs, but again, I'm not sure that really constitutes a non-government solution, depending on its exactual terms.
Okay, thank you. Josh. Before we line up for questions, you could begin lining up, but we will have a question that Josh will pose to George, and George has an option of posing a question to Josh. Josh, would you pose your question to George if you have one?
Yeah, my question is, what's your vision of how a system without government deposit insurance works in a crisis on the scale of the 2008 crisis? If you were having widespread bank failures, including of the largest banks in the country, how does this system remain robust in the face of that?
Well, I would first of all point out that among the many arguments for moving away from government deposit insurance is precisely the fact that that insurance arrangement, especially coupled with too big to fail, which is kind of an outgrowth of deposit insurance in a way, those things lead to more crises, as the studies I mentioned pointed out for the whole world. So asking the question, how would your alternative deal with crises, that is, assuming that crises are as likely to happen with the alternatives to deposit insurance that I'm proposing, is begging the question, because the whole point is that deposit insurance as presently structured is itself, according to lots of studies, both in the recent crisis and in others, a major factor driving things in the direction that results in these disasters. So I don't think that an alternative system has to be able to deal with major crises like that, because it can instead help to prevent major crises. That's part of the whole point. Now, there have been studies, including ones connected with the mutual schemes, showing how much those systems can take. And they can take an awful lot. But again, in fairness, we cannot just imagine any crisis of any magnitude and ask that an alternative system be able to handle it. By the same token, of course, we know that our present system cannot handle it. The FDIC has gone in the red three times now, most recently during the crisis, and ultimately has had to get injections for the Treasury, and it has a full implicit backup from the Treasury, as Josh himself has acknowledged. This is a very, very expensive system, and it has not improved in the sense that risk-taking is discouraged. The limited ventures into risk pricing of the premia have not been successful. And here I must say, government agencies will never be good at risk pricing because they're political entities, and it's just not going to ever happen right. The private sector, for all the problems it might face in pricing risk, is surely capable of doing a better job, and to that extent of better containing moral hazard.
Thank you, George. Could you have a question for Josh?
Yes, I do, Josh. My question is, I grant you that no one alternative of those possibilities I mentioned would be able to contain a major crisis. But if we combine higher capital, which we would have by any one way or the other with if we didn't have government deposit insurance, mutual insurance arrangements, double liability for shareholders, which we would still have if it hadn't been for deposit insurance being treated as a substitute, if we combine all such things, and let's allow that insurance itself, again, is a factor in crisis. Is it really, really likely that we would have a worse system and a more dangerous system than we have now?
Yes. Yes, I think so. For a couple of reasons. One is that I think we should be humble about the question of what causes financial crises. I think they can be caused by unforeseen events. And I certainly would not say, as you did, that you know we don't need to worry too much about whether the system will be robust in the face of an enormous global financial crisis, because the system will avoid the creation of an enormous global financial crisis for three reasons. One is that humility, that we don't know all of the things that can cause these crises. And so we need to worry about if a crisis arises for unforeseen reasons. The second reason is that the financial system is a global one, and so we can implement policies here in the United States, but we are still subject to events and choices that are made outside the United States and contagious effects that they can have here. So even if your system was perfect, it would not be global. And then the third problem is what I discussed at the beginning, which is implicit guarantees, that when people reasonably expect that the government will bail them out, you have moral hazard, whether your policies explicitly create that moral hazard or not. And I think that even if it would have been possible to build a financial system from scratch some 100 years ago that would have been based on a system that was much less interconnected with the government, that did not create expectations of government guarantees and protections of all sorts of things, we are not there today, and it will not be possible to make credible political promises to allow institutions to fail. I mean, actually, the biggest demonstration of why we can't credibly promise that is not all the institutions we bailed out, but the one that we didn't. The Lehman Brothers non-bailout and the panic that ensued from that and the lesson that we therefore had to bail out other systemically important institutions. Lehman wasn't even that big. So I think that, you know, even if the system was global and even if we knew that it would protect us from large financial crises reliably, we knew that there were not unforeseen things out there. The problem is that the policy is not even available to us because people will not believe us if we tell them that those are the rules.
Thank you, Josh. Before we throw it open to questions, I want to ask take moderator's prerogative to ask you both the same question from my own situation of slight puzzlement. probably both agree with this against me. I thought that pot deposit insurance is mainly for the widow, the orphan, the people of limited means who are worried about their deposits at the bank. And rich people, well, they'll take care of themselves or invest in other things. So for the widow, the orphan, the person has to worry about his deposit at the bank. Why can't banks simply be told, put the assets of those people, you know, under a certain threshold, into liquid assets like treasury bills, like commercial paper that's assorted with pretty sound companies. Why not just have them do that, and then their deposits will be more or less protected? Is there something wrong with that idea, Josh?
Well, a couple of things, and in a way, this is like Bernie Sanders' postal banking idea. Which is to say that
I look like Bernie, so I guess that's what reminded you. But this is just, you know, treasury bills. It's commercial. You know, the banks just do that. The post office doesn't have anything to do with it.
The problem is just that would become a very unprofitable business. It's essentially like making it not fractional reserve banking anymore. You're saying that you're making them just, you know, cash management stewards, in which case they then will have to charge the customers fees in exchange for those services. I think that, you know, that it's turning banks into a regulated utility. You could do that, but then there would be a cost associated with providing that service, which would have to be borne somewhere. The other thing I would note is that I don't think deposit insurance is just about widows and orphans. Even in a, you know, obviously now the limits have gotten so high, and you can, you know, Fidelity will take your money and spread it across 10 FDIC insured banks, and you get $2 million in insured deposits, and we shouldn't allow that. But it's also for business owners. It's for people who have needs for cash management services. You might have a small business that needs to hold, you know, $100,000 in cash on hand in a demand deposit account that is owned by people who are not poor but who are also not rich. And I think that there's a political prerogative that has to make sure that those sorts of cash management services enjoy protection like that provided by deposit insurance. And again, as I noted, there is this much larger class of people who are at least implicitly protected from default, including in the 2008 crisis, a lot of the bondholders of banks. So I think it is very difficult to narrowly define this, although setting a lower deposit limit and making it per customer would take one step toward doing that.
Yeah. Same question for you, Jules. I didn't just mean widows and orphans. I meant, of course, anybody up to a certain threshold could include small businesses. Could you address the question as well, George?
Yeah, sure. But first of all, I'd like to say that I'm really pleased that Josh and I agree that the post office probably shouldn't be running a bank. Yeah. The difference is I think the FDIC is about as competent as the post office, but with much graver potential harm that it can do. Look, the idea that deposit insurance was for widows and orphans, like the idea that it was for avoiding crises, these are both ex-post rationalizations. They're part of the legend of deposit insurance. We've already seen what it was really for. It was to prop up a bad unit banking system. So later on, of course, it had to be justified in ways that sounded nicer than that. And one of them was, it's for widows and orphans. But of course, the cat got let out of that bag when the insurance premiums were raised and raised again and raised a fourth, fifth, sixth time, and finally when brokers got in the act, and now you can have actually more than a couple million if you play your cards right. There's no limit to how much insurance you can have if you really play the system. And so forget that rationale. It's gone. It's part of the legend. But the anti-crisis thing is also legend. It's legend. It's based on the assumption that people just panic and take their money out willy-nilly from all banks, and that's what makes banking crises happen. But here's the thing. Josh mentioned before that we have branch banking and other structural changes that we didn't have and could have used in the 30s, and look, we still have problems, but this is the great tragedy. Back then, in the 30s, it was the structure. Now, the biggest problem making for rotten banking is guarantees. They are the biggest source of instability. So we've gone from protecting widows and orphans to protecting ourselves into disaster.
Thank you, George. question. So first question from the audience. Give it 22 minutes. 22 minutes. First question from the audience. Go ahead. Okay. Please phrase your question as a question. Speeches you'll deliver after which when we're having drinks.
Sure. Yeah. A program that's often equated to the FDIC is the flood insurance program, and that it encourages an incredible moral hazard of construction and where houses are built, for example, or construction is built. And while say the U.S. Geological Service may be a valid function of government, isn't a more valid and efficacious function of government to simply provide information, to be a clearinghouse of information versus backstopping bad investment or malinvestment? And so my question is what does the history show with regard to the efficacy of government being an effective backstop versus simply a clearinghouse of information? For example, when the stress tests were conducted after the financial crisis, the results of that stress test were obscured. They were clouded to not allow citizens, we're paying for the stress test to be done, to see which banks failed the stress test, for example. So shouldn't that information be well publicized, and shouldn't the government be a clearinghouse of information versus backstopping bad banks?
What other question?
Well, I mean, I'm not necessarily opposed to greater transparency about what's on the balance sheets of banks, but I would note again that we already have a lot of information about what's on the balance sheets of banks, especially publicly traded ones, and it's not clear that the markets use that information in a way that is effective at policing banks, even when they are reliant on funding sources that are not insured by the federal government. I don't think that we saw widespread mispricing of all sorts of things, mortgage bonds, credit default swaps. We saw, as we discussed, money panicking and running away from banks, but far too late to make a difference in terms of actually encouraging them not to make the irresponsible loans that they made in the lead up to the 2008 crisis. So I think that, you know, information is great and useful and it should be out there in the market, and sometimes it helps a lot, but I don't think that it is enough to prevent bank failures, to protect people from bank failures. And I would note then why have the government be the insurer? Again, my contention would be that the government is the insurer whether we like it or not. And as we saw in other countries, we saw governments stepping in, protecting bondholders, preventing large banks from failing, because that was economically necessary to prevent an even deeper economic depression in the wake of the 2008 crisis. So I think, you know, if the government cannot credibly promise not to be the insurer, then it should at least charge a premium up front, and it should at least supervise the banks and impose rules on them about what risks they can take, because we have losses here that are socialized. I fully admit that. Risk-taking is happening at banks, and it is getting borne on the public ledger. The question is, you know, is there any way to avoid that socialization? My contention is no. And therefore, we should at least find a way not to privatize all the profits. We should charge banks in accordance with the stresses and the risks that they put on the financial system, including but not limited to with deposit insurance. I mean, for example, you have some banks that are not too big to fail, whose bondholders will not necessarily be made whole by the federal government. You want those larger banks to be charged for the value of the implicit insurance that they're receiving. And I think there have been attempts to move federal policy in this direction, but it's not always possible to simply get the government out of the insurer business. And if it's going to be in it, we should know up front that it's in the business, and they should price appropriately to the best extent that they can.
George, you want to comment?
Sure. Well, first of all, I'd like to say that lots of things are impossible. In fact, pretty much everything that's not what we have is close to impossible. So when you talk about how we can't get away from deposit insurance because people just expect it, all right. If we grant that, though, let's grant that we can't get away from the mispricing of the insurance because that's how governments work. And we can't get away from all the other problems. The truth is that if we want to talk about reform, we've got to stop talking about what's impossible. We have to be able to talk about possibilities that actually can work, even if we know that they're very, very hard to achieve. That's the only way we can have reforms that don't lead us to a situation that's not much better than where we started. So I'm idealistic. I can't help it. I don't know if it's because I'm a libertarian. I don't think that's it at all. I think something else is wrong with me. But on the question of information, you know, When the incentive is there for people to get information about banks, it's remarkable how much they can learn and how much more quickly they can react. Governments are not reliable. If you look at the record of governments and bank failures, as slow as the private market, uninsured market may be to respond to losses at banks, as Josh said, it's not fast enough sometimes, but the governments are always the last. The government agencies are practically always the last to know. They come in after the runs. So the runs are late. The agencies, the government authorities, they're later. That's the truth. It's important to look back on the days when there wasn't insurance to see just how much information was out there. Do you know that until the 80s, when I was in grad school, I could go to the Bob's library a couple blocks away from here, and I could look at any number of publications that investigated the safety of banks, because back then the coverage wasn't so complete, and a lot of people wanted to know which banks were safe so they could put their big amounts there. Now those publications, I assume, are all gone. There's no market for people to inquire into those things. Other examples, back in the before the 30s, you could open up the Wall Street Journal and see advertisements for different banks showing how much capital they had and what assets they had. How come? They were selling safety. James Grant, has a wonderful book, Money of the Mind, that talks about the market for safe banks. There were banks that did nothing but cater to people who wanted safety. Safety. It's easy to have a market for safety if you don't make everything safe, regardless, that is, if you don't protect people from the unsafe losses from unsafe banks. Just one more thing on this. Postal savings banks, I think Josh said, well, you can't really have a profitable system that provides widows and orphans with perfectly safe accounts, but that's not true. That's what money market mutual funds can do. They have limited checkability, they have their costs, but in fact, they're perfectly safe, even if they somehow lost value, which is unlikely for the ones that are treasuries only, but we know from the crisis can happen if they have a commercial paper. If they have floating asset value, they're run proof. So it's true that some of the widows and orphans would lose some money in cases like that. Not very much, to judge by this very bad recent crisis. But it's also true that the risks are at least spread evenly amongst the shareholders instead of the people late in line getting whopped and the others getting their money back. Hugh McCulloch taught me that too, by the way. Thanks, Hugh.
Thank you, both guys. Ed Stringham, you have a question.
Yes, Josh, you used the credit default swap market to imply that private markets can't handle insurance very well.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's Ed.
Nice to see you, Ed Stringham. You used the credit default swaps example to say it doesn't work, and I'm wondering if you are using the same doom and gloom, crisis and despair type of argument against private markets. People who bought these equivalent of insurance products knew that there was a possibility of counterparty default on the part of a group like AIG, and groups like Goldman Sachs had collateral requirements for AIG. They also, in many cases, bought insurance in case AIG failed. So if you look at that market, even when Fannie and Freddie were nationalized, that was deemed a credit event, and ISDA basically netted out all of those contracts. I just don't see this mispricing of risk in the same way that you're seeing it.
Well, I mean, AIG had to be bailed out by the federal government at immense cost. And that ultimately was the thing that propped the market up. I mean, so it worked in the end with the government guarantee protecting you, but the government guarantee was instrumental there. And then the other thing I would note is that there is a particular problem here when you have someone who is going to be insuring a particular kind of event that is highly correlated. It's kind of like the monoline insurers, where if you are issuing insurance against bank defaults, in most years you're going to have very few claims, and then occasionally you'll have an awful year where you have a ton of claims. And people, because they can't accurately predict in advance how frequently and how severe financial crises will be, then we don't have enough time to develop the experience to figure out whether the pricing is suitable before we hit a crisis in which the money can't be paid, and then ultimately my contention with this insurance serving as a substitute for deposit insurance is that the government will ultimately end up on the hook for paying that because it will be politically and economically untenable for the money to be unpaid. And this also goes to my, you know, when I say that certain things are impossible, I don't mean that policy change is impossible. I don't mean that all policy ideas are impossible. The impossibility here relates again to this intertemporal issue where we're making policy in advance that relates to rare severe events. And we don't really know how the policy will work until the rare severe event happens. So we can have, for example, we could have changes to deposit insurance premiums. We could do like they do in the United Kingdom and try to base our pricing more on market indicators. And we would have some experience with that on an ongoing basis. We would know both, you know, what it was charging and we would know what the political saleability of that was. The problem is if we are staking a policy on the idea that we're going to make the policy now and it's going to hold when the crisis happens. We can't actually know whether that's going to work until the crisis happens, and in fact, I think we have a lot of experience from the last crisis that tells us that we can't credibly promise that we are not going to bail out various parties.
Do you want to address the question, George? Yeah.
Oh, I don't think I'll address that question directly, but I think that we should be able to credibly commit. The problem is we have arrangements where there were no safeguards against guarantees. For example, the disaster with Lehman's wouldn't have happened if the Fed hadn't been granted the authority to bail out Bear Stearns, which really let the moral hazard evil genie out of the bottle as far as all investment banks were concerned, none of which had ever been under the umbrella of too big to fail before that step. So if the Fed had been reined in, and it still can be reined in, and Dodd-Frank, they made a somewhat feeble effort to do that, but more could be done, you can close the door on certain kinds of guarantees. You can do that, but you've got to put it on paper. If it's not even on paper, of course, that is, if the Fed has the statutory authority or can find it to bail out an investment bank, well, then sure enough, it's more likely that that will happen. But that's not necessarily a problem of time inconsistency. That's a problem of not having sufficiently strict regulations and statutes that tell these institutions what they can and cannot do. We can have better limits on what governments can do.
Next question.
Good evening. Thanks for being here. I love these debates, so it's really exciting. My question is for the gentleman against the proposal. In the insurance industry, companies live and die by properly priced risk pools. What's the mechanism with government insurance to punish poor risk pool management, since the government doesn't compete in the insurance market the same way a private corporation would?
Well, this is absolutely a problem with government deposit insurance. I will admit that. The risk can be mispriced on an ongoing basis. The problem, in the private market, insurers are dependent on pricing correctly in the risk pool, and they learn over time. So we've seen in the Obamacare exchanges, we saw a lot of insurers lost money in those, and they come back the next year and they propose a higher premium and they adjust. Again, I would contend the problem here is that we don't have enough periods of learning, that you don't know whether you've mispriced it until the crisis happens. So I think here there's a significant deficiency in the market pricing that makes this kind of private insurance less workable, less desirable than most other kinds of private insurance. I don't think the government should be your homeowner's insurer. I think we could even find a way to privatize flood insurance. But in this circumstance, there's a quirk that makes it difficult for the private insurers to do the pricing properly. But I certainly admit that the public insurers will also not price properly. That said, I think that there is some room in the political process to make somewhat better choices and even to use private indicators. You can use CDS pricing in the private market to drive your public pricing for bank guarantees. But then, you know, if that pricing is wrong, the market pricing could also be wrong, then the government is still on the hook either way.
You want to comment, George?
Yeah, I would like to say that even though it's true that it's difficult for market insurers and even mutuals to get the risk pricing right, at least in that kind of arrangement, you have stronger incentives against risk-taking. The insurers themselves have powerful reasons to want to watch over the institutions because they've got skin in the game. And in the mutual guarantee schemes we discussed, they can, in fact, step in and say, cut that out or cut this out because it's risking the fund. And so there are much better incentives there. It's true that in Bert Ely's scheme and others, everyone has to be compelled to join the way we're all compelled to buy insurance for driving. The assertion I'm defending doesn't require me to insist that we can't force everyone into a private insurance scheme in order to have such an alternative to government deposit insurance and in order for it to be better. I'm not here to defend libertarianism to court. I'm only defending alternatives to government deposit insurance. But the other point is, I don't see the downside. There are better incentives. We can see that the moral hazard problem is better contained, not just by this one scheme, but by the extended liability and better capital that all should be part of an enhanced alternative system. Yes, if everything goes blotto because of a crisis of the sort we could not have envisioned, the government will step in. But we have that with our existing arrangement. So why not have an arrangement that's better at containing risk-taking in the first place and let the government step in if it has to when things go bad, but they're less likely to go bad than they are with our existing arrangement? That seems like common sense.
Next question.
I guess I have questions for both George Selgin and Josh Barro. One way to greatly, enormously reduce the put value of insurance and therefore the adverse incentives is something that Josh Barro touched on, which is be co-insurance, basically to have a 10% deductible for deposit insurance, and the depositor would immediately get 90 cents on the dollar back if the bank failed. The other 10 cents on the dollar would go into bankruptcy, and maybe you get it back in a couple of years. Maybe you get 9 cents on the dollar, maybe you get 1 cent on the dollar. Do you think that would be that would enormously reduce the scope and the adverse incentives created by deposit insurance? Would you, the two debaters, think that would be a feasible alternative?
George, take that.
I think it would be feasible, but the idea is that if depositors are not fully insured because they're only insured for 90% of their deposits, putting aside any absolute limits, that they still are bearing risk. And that means they have more incentive to do the sort of monitoring against risk and the sort of shopping for safety that is absent with complete insurance coverage. And so the idea is you give a little bit of an incentive, which is better than nothing, and perhaps it would be enough to make a big difference. Of course, the more co-insurance you insist on, the closer you get to a scheme that would be very strong at encouraging avoidance of risky banks. The problem I see with this is not a problem from my own point of view, but from the point of view of those who see deposit insurance as playing a role not just in providing safety for depositors, but in stemming bank panics. For people who believe that panics happen because people run on banks and not because the banks have gotten into trouble for reasons independent of runs, coinsurance sounds like it's not going to solve the problem, because you'd rather have be first in line and get 100 cents on the dollar than join those who are late and who don't run on the bank and settle for 90 or 80 or whatever the coinsurance system is. I don't think that's a problem, because I don't think banks fail on account of runs, or that banking panics are because everybody loses confidence for no good reason in many banks at once. But others, I can see, would have a problem with coinsurance because they believe those theories.
Josh, you want to comment?
Yeah, I mean, I think to some extent, if you had to pay coinsurance on your deposit, you would sort of look like one of the bank bondholders, which is that you might think it's likely that the bondholder probably thinks it's likely that they'll be bailed out, but they don't know. They think that if it did go into bankruptcy, they would get a substantial fraction of their principal back in the bankruptcy. So we already have players in the market who are partially exposed like that. And I think what we saw in the lead up to 2008 crisis was that that exposure was not as useful as we would have hoped for getting those investors to impose discipline on the banks. That, you know, as we discussed, you did get the runs of that uninsured money, but it was not really early enough to be useful in terms of influencing the lending behavior of these institutions. You know, I'm skeptical of this idea that if we hadn't bailed out Bear, then Lehman wouldn't have been such a problem. I don't think it was early enough. Lehman was implicitly already a huge mess at the point of the Bear bailout, even though the markets hadn't quite realized that. And so it would not have been enough time for Lehman to have cleaned up its balance sheet and become solvent. So again, I think the problem is that, you know, you get these you get these warnings, but they're not necessarily early enough. And there are a couple of reasons I can think of not to do it. One is that we've seen in some of these countries that the coinsurance ends up going away as a political matter in the crisis. So then you don't even get the benefit of not having to pay it out. And the other thing is more broadly, and it's a caution against all of these things about, you know, why not go to a private mutual insurer? Why not, you know, try all these other sorts of things to get more market discipline into the system? And one of the answers is because then these things become reasons not to have the banks closely supervised by the FDIC or an institution like it. The main way the FDIC tries to avoid losses is not by charging high premiums. It's by supervising the banks, evaluating their books of business, and telling them that they are and are not allowed to do certain things in conjunction with other bank regulators. And if we come to depend on a market pricing system and say, oh, well, we've got these incentives aligned so that banks will be policed by the people who lend them money so that they won't take big risks, and therefore we can take a lighter regulatory touch, then I think we're likely to find that the system of market-priced incentives didn't work well, and the regulators were less effective than they would have been otherwise because they were not paying as close attention. They did not feel as entitled, or lawmakers decided they were not as entitled to impose their will on the banks as they could under a system where we really recognize that the government bears a lot of these losses and has an interest in regulating how much risk banks take.
We have time for just one quick question, just the question has to be thrown out. I'm not sure we're going to get a chance to. What's the question? Go ahead.
Yeah, I'll try to ask it quickly. So my question is, can you both elaborate a little bit more on the practical risks of actually getting away from the status quo? What I see the situation being is if tomorrow we announced that we're getting rid of the FDIC, the problem would be that there would be the largest bank run in world history, where everyone, because right now depositors aren't actually depositing at banks that they consider safe, so depositors would then pull out all of their money, and then in order to shop, then proceed with the process of shopping around for the financial institution where they want to then deposit. So wouldn't this be a huge practical risk of affirming the resolution?
That sounds like a very good question for George to maybe address in his final 5-minute summation, Josh, you'll get your 5 minutes of summation, and then we'll go to the final vote. So, George, could you give your 5 minutes of summation and maybe address that very good question?
Yeah, I'll start with the question simply by saying that, no, I don't think it's a good idea to just abolish the FDIC and then start figuring out what to do in its place. Of course, you have to design a reform that sees to it that the arrangements that are in place before you remove government deposit insurance are such as can provide depositors a reasonable assurance that their banks will be safe. And it is possible to convince people that their banks are safe through devices other than the FDIC. History shows it, and we lost a lot of those things when we created the FDIC, but we can reinstate them and new things besides that weren't possible way back when. So as for my summary statement, I'd just like to say that we have a system that has shown terrible flaws, that has not produced the safety it was supposed to produce, that has been immensely costly and continues to be so. We have no reason as of right now to predict that there won't be another major crisis, while we do have every reason to predict that the moral hazard problem, which is completely out of control, will be a major contributor to the next crisis. We have to do something to contain that, and that means dealing with the existing system of deposit insurance and coming up with something better. It also means dealing with too big to fail and coming up with something better. Those things are both very, very hard to fix. It's true. Once you've gotten people used to all these guarantees, then they do expect them. But we cannot go on with the arrangement we have now. If we do, we're just asking for another major meltdown. I'd like to point out, though, very quickly, it's not true that the bank runs that happened recently didn't accomplish anything. They accomplished a lot, if only they could be allowed to have their desirable effect. Bank failures are themselves very bad things, and bank runs are very undesirable things, but they have a salutary effect. It's true that they don't always happen in time to get the bankers to straighten out their act. That's not how bank runs work, of course. Bank runs only happen when things have already gotten out of hand. But they have a very nice salutary effect on the other banks in the system, especially when the shareholders of the banks that are run upon take big hits. And that's as it should be. And it's also as it should be, or ought to be, for some creditors to suffer as well, not widows and orphans, but others. These are the essential ingredients for discipline in banking. Without them, there is nothing else that works. Yes, you can try to regulate more and more and more, which is what we've been doing, and we'll end up just killing banking. We'll end up with narrow banking, etc. Very easy to avoid crises if you wipe out the system that you really want to try to make work properly, and which can work properly. It's going to be either the end of banking and bank lending, or reform of deposit insurance along with other things. Those are the two options before us. I favor the latter.
Josh, 5 minutes.
Yeah, I mean, if you're trying to figure out what your deposit insurance policy should be, you need to look at what the problems are that exist today. What do we see as what ails our banking system, and then what is available to us to address that? And I think that, you know, we do have problems with institutions that take excessive risks and that can impose systemic risks on the whole economy when their risks go the wrong way. The problem is that I do not believe we're in a position where we can simply change the rules to make the system riskier for many of the market participants, and therefore get them to impose on everybody else that they must take fewer risks. I believe that that cat has been let out of the bag, and that we saw in other countries that tried to take that approach or approaches closer to it, where they said that they were not going to insure depositors and they were going to rely on depositors to evaluate the soundness of financial institutions. And that those systems proved untenable. And in fact, I think the best example of this is savers in Icelandic banks in the United Kingdom ended up being bailed out by the United Kingdom government. The Icelandic banks got so big it was beyond the capacity of the government of Iceland to bail out those banks, and that responsibility fell on the government of the United Kingdom, which had no legal obligation to do that, but it was just untenable to allow the people who had borne those risks to suffer the consequences of them. So given that, what I think we need to do is we need to define clearly and credibly what the government is on the hook to pay, charge appropriately to the best of our ability, and it won't be perfect, but we can do better than the United States has. Some other countries have done better at that. And then finally, we want to reduce the risk that the government is going to need to pay out to people who hold guarantees from the government, which is to say, especially institutions that are systemically important. To the extent that we cannot make them such that it is possible for them to fail, then we need to charge them appropriately and require them to behave in a way that reduces the risk that they'll fail at all. And I just don't see abolishing deposit insurance as being at all useful in this. In fact, it is likely to make events like major financial crises more panicky because it will be more unclear what guarantees people have available to them. And financial institutions will not have been charged up front appropriately for the risks that they imposed. And again, I would look to 2008 and this question of, do we want more bank failures? Are bank failures salutary because they encourage better behavior among other banks? And there is definitely a theory under which that is true, and indeed, even in a lot of normal economic conditions, that ends up being true. That you see a bank fails because it made a bunch of dumb lending decisions, and other lenders, seeing what that did to that bank's shareholders, make better choices. But in the 2008 crisis, this was just contagion through the whole market, through good banks and bad banks. And you saw at the same time that weaker institutions like Bank of America and Citi and stronger institutions like JP Morgan and Wells Fargo were all under attack because nobody could tell which bank, whether any of the banks were going to be able to survive a systemic crash. It was not something that could be simply left for the market to work out, and it was not something where the good banks would fall and the strong banks would survive and that we would emerge better from it. And to that point, I would note, I don't see any country in the world that took the approach that I think that you would have recommended that they take in this situation. It was a decision all over the world that large bank failures of this sort were unthinkable and would have much more negative economic effects than the acknowledged negative effects that come from having the government take out its checkbook and pay for all of these things. And so obviously that is broader than deposit insurance, but it applies also to deposit insurance. Depositors are among the category of the people who will be bailed out. And so the question is just, do we want to decide up front who we're going to bail out, who we're going to charge for the insurance for that, and to what extent we're going to bail them out? Or do we want to decide in a chaotic, ex post facto manner who we're going to bail out when crises arise? I think that not only is it a better approach to decide up front, I think it's a more libertarian-friendly approach. Because when libertarians are faced with a situation where the government must do something, they should at least prefer that it will set clear rules in advance about what it will do so that it can be done according to rule of law and so that people can know what the rules are going into the situation.
Thank you, Josh. That concludes the debate. Please vote on the resolution a second time. The Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation should be abolished in favor of private sector solutions for protecting the safety of bank deposits. For, against, or undecided. While you're thinking of how you're going to vote, remember that George Selgin is going to be walking over to that table to sign and sell books. $24.95 list just comes to you for $20 bills. So that's a...
You vote wrong.
Well, this voting is... Ignore what George just said. It's confidential, off-the-record voting. You don't have to tell George how you voted. And so you can still get it for the $20. And then remember that Asako Kobayashi, my wife, is having a great art show at George Burge Gallery. There are invitations on the desk. And there you go. Just say Soho Forum. Everything's off 10% off the list price at the gallery. You can't pass that offer up either. And we're going to close the voting, I guess, in a minute when Naomi Brockwell tells us to do so. So we're closing the voting, Naomi?
Yeah.
So could you bring the results up? And I'm going to announce them. No, well. Okay, those in favor of the resolution initially were 48% of the vote, and the vote in favor of the resolution went up by over 11 percentage points to 60% of the vote. So that's the figure to beat. George went from 48% to 60%. The no vote, Josh's vote, remained flat. He picked up 23%. He remained at 23%. So the Tootsie Roll goes to George Selgin.